Hi, my name is Joseph Staley. I'm the curator here for the Glade Cultural Center, and I'm so excited today to share with you one of our most prized possessions here on display in Glade Gallery. This is a large-scale tapestry. It's actually patterned off of Francisco de Goya, who was a Spanish artist who worked back in the 18th century and the 19th century, and it's patterned after his oil on canvas painting, originally titled The Dance of San Antonio de Florida, and depending on who you talk to, it also has an alternate title as well, which would be The Dance on the Banks of the Manzarazas, right, this river right here. So what you see here is a group of majas, majas for the females and majos for the males. And this is an important distinction that took place in Spain, an important title and distinction that took place in Spain during the 18th and the 19th centuries. And the term majo and maja is actually not easily translatable from Spanish to English, but what it basically means is it's in line with this international dandyism movement that took place around this time. So if you look in America, if you are familiar with the movie Django Unchained with Jamie Foxx, if you'll recall him in that movie, he was dressed on a horse in this very bright blue flashy outfit. Again, someone who is maybe of a lower class, someone who's less fortunate, but is dressing up. And so it's not technically like sedate, sophisticated clothing, it's more eye-catching and flashy. So it's a way for people of lower class back again in the 1800s and the 1700s to really kind of give themselves an individual style. While they couldn't really gain attention through their status and their wealth, they could individualize themselves with their elaborate outfit. So that's what they did. And so what we can see here is a dance on the banks of the Manzanares, which again is a river. And Goya actually lived in this exact area that we see pictured here. This was done in 1777. Goya actually acquired the very land pictured here in 1812. So he actually lived here. So it's important to Goya not only in terms of place, but also in terms of subject. We see him exploring from the 19th century back into the 18th century, again, this theme of majas. And he was actually one of his favorite subjects to talk about. So again, Goya is known for portraying the lower classes, people that were less fortunate. And he's also known for really being a harsh critic of the upper classes, especially of French society, because during this time in the 18th century and the 19th century, there was this big divide between Spanish culture and French culture. What you had at the beginning of the 19th century was what was called the Peninsular War, where Napoleon, who after he took over France, sought to expand his empire, and through doing so, he actually descended upon the Iberian Peninsula, which is where Spain is, and attempted to colonize Spain for France. And so you see these two different theologies or these two different methodologies used by the Spanish and by the French. What we see here is a Spanish example of romanticism. It is prioritizing emotion and celebration and dance and fun above rationality and logic. So what you see in France is this heavy emphasis on classicism, of rationality, of logic, of using these forebearers from ancient Greece and Rome and using those philosophies and those ancient mythologies to act as teaching tools. But here in France, or in Spain rather, you have a much different approach. Romanticism flourished, and again, it's focusing on the lower class, it's focusing on revelry, on fun. You can even see here pictured what look like castanets, again, to just make the scene more lively and fun. But this is actually produced in 1980. It wasn't actually produced back when Goya was alive. And part of the original function of Goya's oil painting, which was produced in 1777, was to have a series of tapestries produced to adorn the homes of Spanish royals. And so this really is the best context in which to view this, because this was part of its original function that Goya had at the end of the 18th century. So this is what he eventually wanted to transform into. And while again, it's removed from that time by about a couple hundred years, it's still really important because Goya's idea for this piece was to have it hang in the home of the prince and the princess of Asturias, which were famous Spanish royals. And so again, it was to have this connection to royal society, but also to have a little bit of a critical, take a critical jab at it and not see it as not see the court as something that he should idealize all the time, but something that he should constantly poke at and probe. And while we don't see royals depicted here, again, it's in line with Goya being a little more humble, depicting the sensibilities of people from lower classes and again rejecting that elite culture. And so we're actually very fortunate to have this piece because it shows just how intricate this process would have been back in the 1700s. It was designed and actually manufactured in the same way that it would have been done back then by hand. So all of these individual stitches were hand-stitched. You had a massive loom where a craftsman took almost over a year to produce this image. So again, it's very labor-intensive, it's very time-consuming, but it also offers us a great teaching tool to learn about this time in the history of modern art. Because Goya was at the precipice of the modern and the old masters. So he was technically an old master in that he was prolific in the 18th century, but he also was on the forefront of this modern art movement, again, in an attempt to step away from idealizing the subject, something that was really important during the 18th century and into the Renaissance, and stepping back and creating almost cartoon-like figures, stylizing these figures. I mean, these were originally supposed to be cartoons. And so you're not looking at these figures from a naturalistic perspective, you're looking at them from a stylized perspective, and that's what Goya was trying to achieve. And so whether you're looking at his lower class figures here, or you're looking at his royals, they're all painted in the same kind of humanizing element to where you can see their noticeable flaws. They don't appear like people that don't actually exist in reality. They appear like real, real people. And Goya really, really wanted to show that here. So again, thank you so much for joining us here today. And please submit any questions that you might have in the comment section regarding this work, San Antonio de Florida, The Dance Up. I would really enjoy answering them and getting back to you. Thank you so much.